Okay, I think we can start for the fifth and last AGN tourney 2020. Today we have Guido Risaliti chairing Gabriele Ghisellini and Marcella Brusa, and at the end we're going to have a few words by Beta Lusso. So Guido, it's up to you.
Thank you. I hope you can hear me. I think so, right?
Yes.
And okay. So welcome everybody for this last tourney. So today we have Marcella and Gabriele, who basically will talk about whether we still have enough to work on in this field, right? Or we will have enough in the future. So if you have questions, you may ask to make the question in the chat. Then at the end, I will follow the order in the chat. So Marcella, you are the first, so please start.
Great. I start sharing
And in the meantime, please everybody switch off the microphone. Except Marcella, of course.
It's already on my microphone. Can you start to see the screen? Yes.
Yes.
And this is the presentation. Going into the screen mode. Okay, great. I think I can start. Thanks a lot to Paolo, all the soccer, and Guido for the introduction. For the opportunity to give my perspective or some of my perspective on the topic of the future of aging observation, what is left to be seen. I think many of you will agree with me that to me and Gabriele has been assigned the most difficult topic because it's so broad that it's really hard to give a comprehensive lecture or even 20-minute presentation on this. Days, we have seen that during the previous tourneys, many perspectives for future observation of AGN in the different topics has been already addressed, and this is my personal take on the bottom line and the take-home messages from this presentation, with some highlight on the future facilities that would be in place. And of course, I think the next step is try to figure out also synergies between different topics and over wavelengths. And I think this is the direction we should all move around together for the future. And an obvious example has been offered by the first two topic of the first two tourneys, where it has been shown that how the necessity of having massive black holes in the first giga-year of the life of the universe really triggered a new interest and understanding of accretion mechanism, from the role of super-Eddington accretion and the role of jet spin and so on. So we can really learn a lot on the force accreting supermassive black hole if we understand the accretion mechanism and also the other way around. I will further speculate on these lines and on this topic, starting from my favorite waveband, that of course is the X-ray band. And all I will tell from now on is really related on. Mostly related on the future of X-ray and service in particular. Our future is shown by these two satellites, Erosita on the left and Athena on the right. Erosita is what I call it our near future, and Athena is the far future, of course. In fact, Erosita is more present than future. The date here, 2024, is related to the completion of the All-Sky Survey. These instruments, in terms of X-ray surveys of AGN, are really complementary, as I will show during the talk. And in particular, Erosita will bring to the next level needed to put AGN population studies and demographics within the large-scale structure context and also the time domain aspects, while Athena with its wildfire area instrument will survey a significant area of the sky and will put important constraints on the faint AGN population at all redshift and all accretion and ejection physics. I could talk like an hour about Erosite and what will provide, but of course I will focus only on talk. And with specific, in particular, to some the topic of the evolution of the AGN population. So if we speak about the future, it's better to know where we start from. And this is a very partial, incomplete, biased list of the several breakthroughs we had in the past 20 years, thanks to the exploitation of Chandra and XMM surveys on AGN studies and demographics, and also much more. This is really biased toward the contribution of the Italian community in the field. This was supposed to be the Italian AGN meeting, so this is why I really made a lot of, I highlighted the contribution of the Italian community. But it is not the focus of this talk to be a review of all these results. I just want to highlight a couple of them, and starting from this one, that is the downsizing in AGN evolution. Yesterday, Michaela already showed us how this behavior that basically showed that the most luminous quasar and the peak in their evolution at early cosmic epochs with respect to low luminous quasars is now fully understood in the context of galaxy and the AGN evolution. And I really like to stress and really would like that you appreciate as well that the first evidence of downsizing the AGN population came from the exploitation of the X-ray surveys, and in particular from these works by the put forward by the LF2XMM survey. And at that time, back in 2005, we were dealing with about a sample size of about 100 of AGN, and so we were basically limited to redshift about 3 or 4. And years later, and with a sample size that is 10 times bigger, of course, now this anti-hierarchical growth is much better understood and sampled. And in particular, the necessity of a decline in the redshift X-ray luminosity function that was put forward in XRD synthesis models, now it's very much confirmed. What are the perspective for Erosite and for in another 5 years from now? Well, basically the sample size will be in this case will make a new step forward in this case of about 2 order of magnitude, and given that we will expect to populate the luminosity redshift plane with a few hundred thousands of AGN. These are simulations coming from the Erosite AGN mock catalog presented in Comparatital 2018, showing the luminosity redshift plane color coded with the fractional error that we can associate to a particular luminosity redshift bean. Given the number of sources present expected in that bin. And this error can be as small as 1%, even smaller. That means that we will be able to sample the high luminosity tail and to bring its characterization, let's say, from 7 bins as it is today to up to more than 20 bins and shrink the errors down to 1 to 10%. This means that we will have a really sample size of the size of the one available for galaxy evolution studies. And this has important implication on our fully understanding of the black hole growth in terms of the black hole properties like Victor ratios and so on, and the accretion properties. But even more in 4 years from now, we will have also the first data point at this high redshift, redshift larger than 5.5 with 10% error bars. Really, as of today, we have basically not yet a single data point X-ray selected, as I will show in a moment, in this regime. So what is left to be seen is the slope of the most luminous X-ray population in the GN space density is the ratio larger than 5.5, and this is a reference for the best constraint we have so far. Going back to the luminosity redshift plane, this is a figure we put forward for one of the Athena supporting paper back in 2013, and updated, I think, by Andrea Merloni on putting also the Eurosita data. And this shows how this plane is populated by current Chandra and XMM Newton surveys, and then the forthcoming Eurosita and Athena surveys. This compilation is as of 2017, but I can confirm that as of today, the highest redshift spectroscopically confirmed and X-ray selected quasar from current Chandra XMM surveys is still the one redshift 5.3 reported in Capac et al. 2011. This does not mean that we do not have an idea of which are the X-ray properties of the force accreting black holes, the one that have been presented on Monday by Roberto. And in fact, this is the current region of this plane populated by the few detections with respect to the hundreds of sources that we have at this high redshift that has been explored via follow-up observation of optically selected or color selected dropouts. That means the problem is that given that this is a follow-up, we cannot really construct a blind X-ray luminosity function. Plus, when you follow up one sample, you always make some choices that are for sure the smartest one, maybe the most massive black holes, maybe the most luminous and so forth, but this bias for sure your understanding of the X-ray properties. In the game, by observing and putting forward, really for the first time, the most luminous quasar emitting the X-rays at this very high redshift. These points here represent the very conservative expectation we had, and only limited to the German part of the sky, we had at the time pre-launch of Eurosita. And we are revising it right now. I will tell some few things more later. But after less than, I think, not even 1 month of the survey, the first OSCE survey of Eurosita, our Russian colleagues reported the detection of what it is now the most X-ray luminous quasar redshift larger than 6. And this is a zoom of the luminosity redshift plane, where the Eurosita detection is highlighted here. This was a known quasar at redshift 6.18. This is a radio loud object that makes the object, it's a complication, but it makes it even more interesting. The point is that, of course, this detection is based on just 300 seconds of Eurosita observations, and the spectral parameters are really constrained quite poorly, especially the spectral index and the X-ray to optical spectral slope. So speaking about the X-ray to optical spectral slope, there is a very known anti-correlation between this quantity and the UV luminosity that in fact reflects a tight relation between the X-ray luminosity and the UV luminosity. And in turn, this reveals a universal physical mechanism that it's able to regulate the energy transfer from the accretion disk to the X-ray emitting corona. We have seen some speculation on this already on choosing the presentation by Margherita. And in practice, the X-ray to optical flux ratio can be also related to the presence or the absence of line-driven disk winds. So, and also all these properties are related to the accretion properties and the ending ratio of the sources. So it's really important to study this kind of, let's say, observables, even at, especially at very high ratio. So what's the status of what's the status and how the current known and X-ray observed quasars at redshift larger than 5.7, this limit mimic the selection or the limit in a redshift for the selection using the dropout technique for putting together basically all the objects observed so far from this compilation. Again, I want to highlight and stress the contribution of the Italian community by the work of Riccardo Nani and Fabio Vito. So, the collaborators. And the bottom line here is that the relation, this is valid only for radio quiet quasars, is apparently consistent with low redshift AGN, and there seems to be no significant changes in accretion mechanisms. But at this stage, we should ask ourselves, are these measurements reliable, and if they, especially the spectral slope is constrained enough. So, talking about Erosita, this is the sensitivity of the Earth-Sky survey in this plot for the Earth-Sky for the poles. Basically, this is the alpha X limit versus the UV luminosity for a quasar detected at the flux limit. So, Erosita, if present, they will reveal basically all the quasars in the universe that populate on this right part of the diagram. Indeed, the first X-ray detected and the most luminous quasar detected by Erosita is lying in this region, not surprisingly. Of course, the fact that it is radio loud may explain why it is significant deviating from the alpha OX relation. And this is also the case of another radio loud object that has been detected again this year by Silvia Belladitta and collaborators from the Milano group. In this case, it's ABLASA. In both cases, the spectral index in the X-ray is quite flat, and the X-ray emission is probably enhanced by the presence of the radio emission and mechanism which involve jet and log X-ray emission. I want to stress and highlight also here that based on a much larger analysis of radio loud quasars, of a sample of 700 radio loud quasars, Zhu et al. From the Penn State group put forward the interpretation that the X-ray excess in radio loud quasars may be due to brighter coronas. And the combination of bright corona, the role of magnetic field, and the spin is maybe the mechanism that could launch the jets. I don't know if Gabriele can add something or will add something on this in his talk later. But the question that that we can ask is how common are they? How common are these radio loud X-ray luminous quasars at high redshift? Is this the situation for most a large fraction of the most accreting black hole? And especially are there X-ray loud but radio quiet quasars, so maybe populating this region of the diagram? This is again left to be seen, and Erosita will answer on this. Going inside to the low luminosity part of this X-ray luminosity redshift plane, this is where Athena will enter the game. And in particular, Athena will probe this luminosity range, and the multi-tier WFI survey has been indeed designed to constrain black hole seed models by counting the objects and revealing enough objects in this luminosity redshift range. Here in this slide, I really want to highlight, because I think this was not touched on Monday, that X-ray luminosity functions and number counts have predictive power for black hole seed models. And this is shown here. This is the extrapolation to redshift 6 to 7 of one of the most conservative X-ray luminosity function in terms of evolution at high redshift. And the points plus error bars are how well we will be able to constrain with the objects detected in the Astina surveys that are listed here in terms of number of objects in each bin, the luminosity function in this particular redshift bin. So we will then be able to compare the luminosity function, the observed luminosity function, with the prediction from black hole seed models. This is one quite recent prediction put forward by Ricard et al. In 2018, where you have different behavior for heavy and light seed. At first, you may get the impression that we are completely wrong with our expectation. In fact, if the models are good, if the models are telling us the truth, the Athena AGN service will provide data points that are one order of magnitude larger in terms of space density. That means also that we will have statistical error even much smaller than the one plotted here, and that we will be able to disentangle between different seed models. Of course, all of these provided that the PSF will remain at 5 or 6 arcseconds. And well before Athena, Rosita will provide, as I said before, the first measurement of the high luminosity part of this extra luminosity function at high redshift, with enough accuracy, but we are almost ready to put forward some preliminary results based on the PV phase survey of Rosita. So stay tuned in the next few weeks or months for exciting results on this. And all of these will, of course, help shaping Athena survey strategy. So the Athena, if we go back to the alpha OX plot, the Athena sensitivity curves, similar to what has been presented by Rosita, are these ones. And so Rosita and Athena will be really, will work really in a synergetic mode to explore all the possible accretion mechanisms that may give rise to this correlation. And in particular, Rosita, thanks to the its limited field of view, will reveal all the most luminous radio loud AGN that or even not that may exist in the universe, while Athena, with a well-thought survey, even if only limiting to 50 square degrees or so, will deliver similar sample size of low luminosity AGN, and which are probably the most interesting where to search for strong winds. Another obvious synergies may be to point Athena on all the Rosita detected quasars, and with few kiloseconds or up to 10 kiloseconds observation, you will get spectral accuracy in the spectral index in the X-ray properties that are not feasible right now unless using very deep observations. And this is my final point, the significant spread in the X-ray photon index that we see observed for the few sources for which we could obtain single constraint at redshifts for steepening of the gamma at very high redshift. This could be the indication that indeed these sources are accreting at very high Eddington ratio values, and this could be explored by comparing, given that the gamma encoded formation, the accretion rate, and the geometries of the X-ray corona, a better handling of the spectral parameters really gives you better understanding of the accretion mechanism. And this can be also achieved with dedicated deep follow-up campaigns with XMM and Chandra on already known high redshift quasars without waiting for Athena and Rosita synergies. And I think I can stop here with the main conclusion of the talk and my take-home messages. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Marcella. And I think we can leave the questions for both the speakers at the end. Gabriele, are you ready to?
Yes, I'm stop sharing the screen.
Yes, your entire screen. Now, right, do you see?
Yes.
Do you hear me?
Good. Yes. Good.
I thank, first of all, I thank the organizer to have invited me as an old guy, and I like to draw your attention to the spear or lance of this night. that you recognize as being the M87 jet. That's why. That's because I will talk mostly about RadioLoud AGN in this talk. But first, let me remind that we live, I think, in a very strange, interesting, never seen before epoch. That's the epoch where the computing capabilities is really taking off. And from now on, it's my idea that the world will, and even our world will change dramatically. We can see something of that kind even now, because I don't know if you noticed, but there are many papers presenting models, ideas, and comparing this model to ideas, not to reality, but to the illustrious simulation. So I don't want to judge this this thing, because I, even if it is bad or wrong, I don't know, is the future. Either if you want it or not, virtual reality will be normality in the future. On the other hand, and somewhat paradoxically, we have very near in the future, we will be flooded by terabyte and terabyte of data. Take the LSST, for instance. It will open up the time domain astronomy. It will monitor millions, dozens of millions of sources every day. And that will be very, very difficult to walk through this forest of data, and it will be very easy to be confused. And so I have a suggestion, or no, I did this thinking, leave some time for thinking, not only for analyzing data, explain to students what they are doing in such a way that they understand the aim of their thesis, and remember that, I think at least, that observations are not the goal, but observations are the mean to understand reality. This is the end of this sermon, and let's talk about something more interesting, maybe. You may know that recently LIGO and Virgo have detected the merging of two big black holes that have formed an even bigger black hole. And maybe that all three lie in the fairly stability gap. And so their masses are difficult to understand, and they were not predicted. But just a few days ago, there was a paper in AstroPH. One of the co-authors was Alberto Cesana, saying that since it is difficult to form black holes of by normal stellar evolution by masses, as we have seen, even 88 solar masses, one possibility is that they leave these binaries within an accretion disk. And this accretion disk provides matter accreted by these black holes, and they can reach their masses through accretion. On the other hand, they go around the supermassive black hole, and so in the future, when LISA will be operating, there is the possibility that LISA can detect these binary black holes even months or 1 year before they merge. And this is an extraordinary observational advantage, because you can first of all, understand if they, I mean, you can have 1 degree or so of error circle. You can find the accretion disk, the AGN that is hosting these things. And you can, you know, provide the good candidates for LIGO Virga to follow the final moments. Another topic, completely different, is neutrinos. Very high energy neutrinos have been detected by IceCube, and one of them has been associated to a blizzard. And I mean, of course, having one almost good candidate, and I think a few others not so good candidates is not enough to be sure that this association is real. And so what we have to do is to go on. So this go-go is either go on or neutrinos are go-go. And the candidate is the famous source TXS 0506. These are some error circles of the different instruments. And it was found, this source, not to be an extreme Bielak as expected. What is an extreme Bielak? It's a Bielak who's said is peaking in the X-rays for synchrotron and in the GVTV region in for the inverse compton. Instead, it is an intermediate blazar, so it's not producing a lot of very high energy gamma rays. And despite that, it is able to produce neutrinos of almost a PeV, so 10 to 15 electron volts. And if that is real, it means that in this source, there are for sure very energetic protons. To produce these neutrinos, you must have a proton that is 20 times as energetic. So it's 10 to 17, more or less, electron volt. These protons are carried by the jet, and their existence, therefore, requires extra power for the jet, because the jet has to carry them along the way. So how much more power do we think it is needed? Now, if you account, you think that you have only those protons needed to produce the neutrinos, you end up having a few times more than the usual jet power that you have calculated before in leptonic models, for instance. On the other hand, if you assume and pretend that the entire spectrum, the entire LCD is due by hadronic processes, then you end up having a few thousands more power in the jet. So an incredible power. The question is, and the doubt is that we already find out that the jet is more energetic, is more powerful than the accretion disk. And so the presence of these neutrinos and the corresponding protons will exacerbate these problems. And remaining into the high energy domain, there is an interesting proposal that the strange features that we see at very high energy when we deaden the TeV emission detected by MAGIC, Hess, Veritas, and so on, we sometimes end up having a very strange spectrum, too high flux. And so we start to know quite well what is the extragalactic background light that is producing the absorption. We cannot go below some value. And so why do these high energy photons survive this crossing of this stormy ocean in that is absorbing them? It may be that part of the travel, these photons, change nature and they become axions. The axions are new particles, not yet detected for sure, that have been proposed as the dark matter particle. So even that observations helping to find out if the axions exist are very risky, very dubious, but very rewarding if you find something. Now, to finish up the high energy, very high energy CTA. CTA is big. It has a huge collecting area. So it will discover variability, even factor two variations in less than a minute for a radio loud and gamma ray loud AGN. And if this is so, then this will tell something and will pose a very difficult problem to solve for the geometry of the source, for the acceleration process, and also to the bulk motion, that if that that happens, it must be much more than what we think until now. Radio loud, radio quiet. We know that this is a long standing question. What is that makes an AGN radio loud, that makes a jet in an AGN? And the answer, we don't have any answer yet, but because the question is difficult, but at least we can see, we can go on having a small piece of the puzzle resolved. So my question is, do the jets exist in spirals, and how many? I'm thinking to that, to the narrow line sifted ones that are radio loud and gamma ray loud. Are they really in spirals? So we need some good image, presumably by HST, to solve this question. Not very difficult. So I don't know why it is not yet completely solved. And another big question unsolved is at what luminosity there is the transition between the relatively efficient disk and the relatively inefficient disk, so to speak, when the Shakura-Sunyaev disk becomes an EDAF, an advection-dominated accretion flow. And what is the spectrum corresponding to an EDAF, apart from the our galactic center? And what is commonly observed? We don't know yet, and part of the reason, I think, is that the EDAF in radio quiet AGN should be without broad lines. So it is very easy to be confused and to classify the sources as type 2 AGNs. Maybe that the looking at the radio loud sources, maybe BLX that don't have the obscuring torus is more efficient and rewarding. Narrow line versus broad line region. I was put into this study recently together with a student of mine, and I was asking, but are we sure that the narrow line region is photoionized by the same ionizing photons produced by the disk? And I'll be sure that, therefore, the narrow line region luminosity is a proxy for the luminosity of the disk, as in this pioneering paper by Rowling and Saunders and Celotti and Fabian, that are relating the jet power to the luminosity of the narrow lines. And to answer the question, where the photoionization cones are going, seems that they are desaparecidos by now, and were very common 20, 30 years ago even, when HST was launched. And can we say something through the line ratios or the correlation between narrow and broad lines? And do you have any idea on how to answer this question? Now, as Marcella already anticipated, there is a big interest in what is the universe less than a billion after years after the Big Bang. And this is because we keep finding black holes in the high redshift universe that have already 1 billion masses. So speaking of these big black holes, you have this figure, in which the blue line is the density of big black holes, masses greater than 10 to the 9 solar masses for radio quiet sources, while in orange you have the same quantity for radio loud sources. You see that the ratio between these two is not constant, is not 10%, is jetted sources seems to have big masses at high redshifts. But the question is, do you need to have a jet to form a high mass black hole, or do you need a high mass black hole to form a jet? What is the, you know, the kitchen and what is the egg? And we don't know yet. But I think that this is an interesting question that will put light on the process of forming big black holes. And I must say that I don't have anything against a period of phase in which you could naturally have a super Eddington accretion. But this is more common in radio loud than in radio quiet sources. Now, I decided to finish to be a little bit masochist and to produce an observation, an idea of observation to challenge the Blaser sequence. The Blaser sequence is what you see here. There is a trend in blazars, and the main parameter controlling the trend is the total luminosity, the observed luminosity. As you increase the luminosity, the SED shift to the left, and the high energy bump that you see here becomes more dominant. And the explanation that one does is that in more powerful sources, the cooling of the particle is stronger. And so the particles, the emitting particles, do not, cannot reach very high energy, and so they produce smaller frequencies. And so everything goes to the left. Now, there is a competing idea made by the two Paulis, Giomi and Padovani, that said that it's not true, this idea that the energy of the particles depends on the luminosity, is an effect, an apparent effect, is given by selection effects. And all blazars, more or less, the majority of blazars, have a gamma peak. The Lorentz factor of the particles that are emitting at the peaks is 1,000, no matter the luminosity. So I thought that if this is true, then there will be some VLUX that appears very red instead to be blue, so high energy, and not having the broad lines, the main process is synchrotron and SSC, synchrotron self-Compton, and having these low energy particles inside, it will have a high energy, the energy peak is peaking in the S-rays. And this could be found by E-Rosetta. If E-Rosetta finds a source without or with very weak lines whose high energy spectrum is for sure synchrotron self-Compton peaking at a few kV, then this will be a very challenging source to explain, for explaining, I mean, to be explained with the Blaser sequence. Now, when we started these national meetings on AGN, we are 60 or 70, then the number stabilizes to 100, more or less. It's 26 years that it is, therefore, more or less 100, a lot of young people, and this demonstrated that the field is very well alive and interesting, even if it is getting older. And I think that in the future, most of the action, for a while at least, will shift to very exotic and somewhat unexpected issues, and Blaser will be used as probes of, big physical questions like, as I said, axions and neutrinos, and even if I didn't say anything about that, the Lorentz invariance violation. That's all, and thank you for attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Gabriele. And it's now time for questions. So I don't see anything in the chat until now, but if you're, anybody has questions, raise your hand through the chat. While waiting, I may ask a question. And I don't know, I mean, to both of you, basically. And so one thing which you didn't discuss about what is left to be seen, what could be seen in the future, which is completely new, is regarding the high spectral resolution in X-rays that is opening up, hopefully, recently. So, I mean, do you think that there will be, you know, room for breakthroughs in that, in this observational field, which has, of course, applications in many subfields, I mean, in many aspects in the AGM physics?
Okay.
Well, I mean, it's for both of you.
If you can resolve the corona, of course, I mean, it's fantastic. And it depends on the resolution. Thanks to what the LBI has done for the radio, and multiply by some factor greater than unity, because with this big resolution in X-ray, of course you are going just there where the power is, you know, it is formed. While instead in the radio you are at parsecs distant from the very center. With X-rays you could, but depends on the resolution.
Well,
I don't know.
If I may add, speaking about spatial resolution, this is far beyond any future we can foresee. There has been this proposal for the Voyager 2050 observatory doing interferometry in X-rays, and that will be the instrument to spatially resolve the corona and the accretion, the innermost accretion regions. Speaking about spectral resolution, of course, we have something much more in the future and much more close to us, CRISMA, and then the XIFU of Athena. I didn't touch these two instruments because in what I presented were not that relevant, I should say. The survey part of Athena was more relevant and the most important one. But of course, and this has been mentioned by Roberto Maiolino on yesterday a bit. Of course, if we really want to resolve and understand the effect of AGM feedback in the galaxies, we need high spectral resolution also in the X-rays and in all other wavelengths. So this is a synergy that can be applied to other science topics like the UFOs versus kiloparsec scale winds, or the turbulence induced in the ISM by the past or present AGM activity.
I am sorry to have understood the question. I thought of a spatial resolution, but I think that there is a reason for that, because when Roberto Citeri was still active, he was keeping asking me what I thought of the Emory-Brown possibility to reach a very high spatial resolution in this very strange way, correlating the intensity of two X-ray telescopes, you know. And that's partly the reason why I misunderstood you.
Okay, yeah, but anyway, your answer to the spatial resolution point was interesting. A question by Giorgio Gabriele. So Giorgio, please, go on. I don't know if Giorgio has the microphone active. Otherwise, I can Giorgio's
Do you think the issues you mentioned can at least partly be addressed by any energy polarimetry? Example is the Lorentz invariance violation. Yes, the answer is surely yes, and I think that the polarimetry, I'm told, I don't know from my side, is a very powerful, a strong probe of these issues. So, yes.
Any other question? So, just another minute. Well, if there are no questions, well, that means that we will be on time also today, because we have also the conclusions by Beta. But if there are other questions, we can go on for a few more minutes. Okay, if not, I think we can thank our speakers again. Thank you very much. And Beta, so you have some conclusions?
I was asked to give concluding remarks for this AG and Tornis, so we are at the end. And on behalf of the LOC, I would like to thank all of our knights that have fought with extraordinary bravery, I should say, these days. I believe that they have made this IGN Tornis a success, so hope you agree with me. I should also say that all the talks have been recorded. They sent me some emails asking me if all the videos will be put online. The answer is yes, and an email will be sent with the link. A few remarks before saying goodbye. So, as you know, the decision to go virtual for these virtual meetings has been taken due to the pandemic situation, which forced us to postpone the IGN 14 conference by 1 year. Nonetheless, I very much like this format, and so I hope you agree with me. And we can use it again, hopefully in person rather than virtually. So these IGN Tornis can be just the first of a series. As you have seen these days, science doesn't stop, even with the COVID-19. And scientists need to review results, need to meet, need to discuss future perspectives for not only the old but the young. So future perspective of astrophysics in all fields, in these fields in particular. So now more than ever, I believe we need to have other resorts in order to keep us updated and the community strong. So my closing is supposed to be brief and informal, so I'm about to end, but I cannot actually leave you without thanking the great work done by the scientific organizing committee and the local organizing committee. And of course, a big, big applause. So you can applaud Paolo Tozzi that has made IGN Tornis a reality. So I'm done. I hope to see you all again in person. So in Firenze in October 2021 in Flesh and Bones. So have a good life and stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you, Beta. And so that's it. And yes, I join Beta in thanking everybody who organized this Tornis and Paolo in particular. I don't know if Paolo, you have a final word.
No. Just too many thanks. I mean, thanks to everybody and to all the people that participated to the Tornis. So we had 100 people minimum each day, and so I think, as Beta said, that we kept the community alive, and we really hope to see everybody in person next year.
Thanks. Paolo.
Thanks to everybody.
So thank you. And goodbye, everybody.
To come to Florence next year.
Bye.
Ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao. Ciao. Ciao. Ciao.
Ciao,
ciao. Ciao,
grazie.
Ciao a tutti. Ciao, ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao, grazie.
Ciao, grazie.
Ciao a tutti.